Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Buddhang Dhammang Sanghang Namassami. As was said in the introduction, thank you very much for that. The 100th anniversary of Lumpur Cha's birth occurred on the 17th of June, so just a few days ago. It was 100 years after Ajahn Chah's birth in Bangkok, in a little village in Ubon province in northeast Thailand. So this time we are celebrating this great occasion, and also over the next few days here at BIA there will be a program of other Ajahns from Wat Nombopong and its branches to lead events here, I think all in the Thai language. But we're beginning things in English this evening. I think it's quite suitable as Lumpur Cha's community is a very international sangha. So I suggested the title of Who Was Ajahn Chah as a title for this evening, since it has a variety of ways you can answer that question. And so I will start with speaking about his life from the most ordinary sort of historical perspective. So this is the first way of describing a person. So Lumpur Cha was born in Bangkok, the little village in Ampur Warin, Ubon Ratchathani province, June of 1918, and he was one of quite a large number of children, I think 8 or 9 children in his family. And he was unusual insofar as he chose to go into the monastery at the age of 9. He was 9 years old, and he wasn't sent there by his parents, but rather on his own motivation, he left the home life and signed up as a dekwat, as a temple boy. And he stayed in the monastery of his own village as a dekwat, as a temple boy, for a few years, and then received novice ordination, I believe, when he was about 11 or 12. He then trained as a novice until he was 16, and then during that time, his teacher, his Ajahn in the monastery, Ajahn Lang, was his kind of guide and mentor. And he would go and take the young novice Cha, or Nen Ng was his name, Ng, as a bullfrog. Novice bullfrog was his nickname, Nen Ng. And Nen Ng was very impressed that the Ajahn would take him off to visit the Chuang Chot family, his Ajahn Cha's family, and spend a lot of time teaching his mother and father. He then found out that Ajahn Lang was actually interested in Ajahn Chah's elder sister. And so to his great surprise, his Ajahn disrobed and then proposed to his Ajahn Chah's elder sister. And so then with his Ajahn disrobing and leaving the Sangha, then also being the age of 16, then he ended up leaving the robes at that time as well. So then he took on the lay life for a few years. When he was 16 to the age of 20, and then during that time he also fell in love with a local girl from the village. And those of you who have read Lumpur Cha's biography will know that that was a difficult situation for him, because his best friend was a young lad called Put, and Put had a half-sister called Jai, and it was Jai that the young Cha Chuang Chot was in love with. So they were assuming that they would get married and live together, and they were kind of beginning to plan a future. And then one day his friend Put said, "Yeah, I'm sorry, but they're marrying me to the girl." And so he was in an arranged marriage to Jai. So his best friend and his girlfriend got married together. So that was, as they say, tough. That was a tough deal. And so, what better thing to do than to go back into the monastery? So that that was the motivation, or the kind of impulse for him to go back into the monastery, was the kind of suffering of the heartbreak that he had. And then he lived in the village temple. He was very bright, and so he learnt Buddhist studies and some Pali and became quite a responsible member of the local temple. But then after he'd been a bhikkhu for about 6 or 7 years, then his father fell very ill. And then it was the slow fading and the death of his father that was the impulse for him to take up meditation. Because as most of you probably know, in many of the village and town temples, the Sangha members don't do a lot of meditation. But they do a lot of ceremonies, they study Pali, they are performing a lot of what you would call pastoral roles, helping people, giving advice, but they don't do a lot of bhavana, of meditation. But with his father fading and dying, then the young bhikkhu, Cha Subhato, he realized, I don't know what to do with my mind. I'm feeling sad, I'm upset, I feel powerless, my mind is all over the place. I'm a bhikkhu, I'm a monk. We have all these stories about the Buddha and these enlightened wise beings. I'm not wise. My mind is not focused. I have no samadhi. I'm all over the place. I need to do something about my mind. And so that was an impulse for him to take up meditation, was the dying of his father. And so then there's this very famous dialogue between him and his father when his dad was on his deathbed, and his father said, please don't disrobe. Promise me that you'll stay as a monk. And so that the young bhikkhu, Subhato, Acha Subhato, said, yes, I promise I will stay as a monk. So then he traveled and sought out some meditation teachers. He took on the life of a forest monk, a wandering monk living in the forests, and he met with a number of different teachers in that area. There was Lumpu Kinari and also Lumpu Tongrat. These were Mahanikaya forest monks who had trained with Venerable Ajahn Man, but were local to the Ubon area, and so he was. They were the first forest ajahns that the young bhikkhu Cha Subhato sought out and trained with. So as time went by, then he got more and more serious about his practice, and a great deal of faith and commitment arose, and he made this resolution during this time that he was pressured by the feeling of dukkha, of suffering, and it was so important to him, and he saw that the teaching of the Buddha and the way of life of the forest monk, this was the most precious opportunity to really understand life and to bring suffering to an end. And because his suffering, his dukkha, was so intense, mental suffering rather than physical, he said, okay, I'm going to use this life to arrive at the end of suffering. Whatever it takes, I'll do it. So he made a very firm aditana, a resolution, when he was a young monk. And this is also a famous part of his history, that he made that kind of strong commitment to whatever it takes, whatever I have to do, I'll do it. And when he was a child, he was always the kind of extremist. He was always the one who would try hardest, climb the tree highest, work hardest in the field. He would always, if he was going to do anything, he would do it 110%. And so if he's going to be a monk, he's going to do that 110% as well. So he really committed himself very firmly to the practice. And then having trained with Lumpur Tongrat, Lumpur Kinari, they had both been disciples of Lumpu Man, who was the most well-known forest Ajahn of that era. And so the young Ajahn Chah then went to see if he could find Venerable Ajahn Man, Lumpu Man. And so he went to find him. This was in the last years of Lumpu Man's life. And Ajahn Chah met him at his monastery in Nongpur in Sakonnakhon province. And he only spent 3 days with Lumpu Mun. And so Lumpu Mun was a Dhammayut monk, and Lumpu Cha was from the Mahanikai, different lineages. And so again, part of our history is this dialogue after the young Bhikkhu Cha Subhato had been with Ajahn Mun for a few days. Great faith and confidence in Lumpu Mun's teaching arose in him. And he thought, this monk is truly enlightened. He definitely knows what he's talking about, and I'd like to follow his teaching. So he asked Ajahn Mun, so should I let go of my precepts as a Mahanikai monk, and should I reordain Bod Ik in the Dhammayut lineage? And then very famously, at least in our community, then Lumpu Mun said, no, you don't need to change lineages. They need good monks in the Mahanikai community as well. You should stay as you are. So that's what he did. One of the most significant teachings, every evening Lumpu Mun would give a Dhamma talk, and on that the third evening that he was there, he gave a particular teaching that was to inform Thanajan Cha's practice ever after. And that was that Lumpu Mun made it clear that the mind that is aware and the objects of awareness are separate. There's a transcendent quality, a locutora quality to that awareness. That is why liberation is possible. So that which knows the five khandhas is not intrinsically tied to the five khandhas, the kanha, the body, the feelings, perceptions, thoughts and emotions, consciousness. That which knows the five khandhas is not part of the five khandhas, it's not tied to that. That's why liberation is possible. If every kind of awareness was intrinsically part of the five khandhas, liberation would be impossible. And so, but because there is this quality of awareness, the puru, or you can say vijja, the quality of knowing, because that is, an aspect of our mind and it is transcendent over the five khandhas, therefore liberation is possible. And so that had a very powerful effect on the young Ajahn Chah. And so he took those teachings and then carried on to live as a forest monk. So to cut a long story short, he began to teach in 1953, before I was born. Well, maybe I was alive somewhere else, but before I was born in this life. And he initially took on a few students, disciples, and he had a pansar together with four or five other novices and monks with a famously vigorous routine. So they had an all-night meditation every night. So every monk and novice had to sit up in meditation all night, every night, for the whole 3 months. And then for the last month, just to kind of crank it up even more, yeah, everyone had to sit up all night and not move. So it was a 12-hour sitting with no moving every night for a month. At the end of that retreat, there were a few survivors. And there was a couple of those who were with him, stayed with him, and continued as his first ongoing disciples. The people from Bangkok, including his mother, heard that he had come back into the area and that he was undertaking teaching, that his reputation as a really good and committed, pure-hearted monk had spread. And so then this delegation from Bangkok came to find him and said, please, we have a forest near the village, as you know, please can you come and live in the Bapong forest, and we will support you to start a monastery there, to practice there. So that was 1954, in March 1954, then Mina Songpan Haroy, Siroy Gaosip Jet. Thank you. Songpan Harai Gaosip Jet. So March of 1954. So that's when Wat Pah Pong began. And then he stayed there and taught continually. And then people gathered around, both Thais and foreigners, and the community was established. And he taught in an unrelenting way. He was always available to give teachings. And so by the time I arrived at the beginning of 1978, then it was the case that most of every day Lumpo Cha would sit under his kuti and receive people from after the mealtime at about 9 o'clock through until maybe 9 o'clock in the evening, maybe 10, maybe midnight, maybe after the lay people had all gone by midnight, then he would stay up to maybe 1 or 2, maybe 3 in the morning, talking with the monks and novices. Then often you'd hear the morning bell going at 3 o'clock, and he'd say, okay, time to take a rest. So then he would go off and rest for a couple of hours, and then time for bindabat, for alms round at 5:30 in the morning. So he was an incredibly generous teacher. But that had a powerful effect on his body, and so by the time he was in his early 60s, in 1981, so when he was about 63 years old, his health started to really degenerate, and then he had some kind of a stroke or some kind of a brain lesion that they're not quite sure in that time, and he over a period of 7 or 8 months, his health degenerated, and so after he reached the Pansa of 1982, at the age of 64, his health had degenerated to the point he couldn't speak, he couldn't walk, he couldn't move, and he was paralyzed. So then, for the last years of his life, he lived until 1992, so 10 years. He was looked after by his disciples and nursed, and finally he passed away January the 16th of 1992. And it was also a testimony to the monks and novices who were looking after him that he was bedridden for 10 years and he never got a bed sore. He was very, very well looked after and with great respect. So that is the story of Lumpo Cha's life. So by the time he passed away, there was something like about 50 or 60 branch monasteries. Now there's over 340. So his teaching has spread by a great degree since he passed away. And so that we are very grateful that he set things up in a way that was extremely skillful, so that after the great master died, then his teaching didn't fade away, because that's often what has happened with the other great Ajahns. So when we think, well, who was Ajahn Chah? So that's a biography. That's a little bit longer than I planned, but you know. But then another way of approaching that was as our own personal experience. So I can only really say from myself, I could tell other people's stories, but from my own stories, I was just being interviewed by the Chung Sam Channel 3 TV, and they were asking me about the very first conversation I had with Ajahn Chah. So I was 21 years old, I was a hippie, straight off the beach. I literally had sand in my hair and a seashell hanging out of my ear. And I was a hippie, so I didn't like rules, I didn't like any limits, but I was an unhappy hippie. I was really looking for some way of working with my mind in a direct way. I had the idea of myself as a kind of spiritual person. You know, I'm beyond sort of worldly concerns. I'm only 21, but you know, I feel I'm more spiritually advanced than at least the people I was hanging out with in my university or in the village where I grew up. So I had a kind of high opinion of myself. And when I met Ajahn Chah the first time, he was building a toilet. It was a Hong Suom. So he had my head was filled with these kind of inflated ideas, like, oh, it's very significant, he's building a toilet, he's very down to earth. He had a cement trowel in his hand, he was kind of smoothing the cement. So, oh, the great spiritual master, he's building a toilet, this is very symbolic, this is kind of all kinds of laden with meaning. And so, yeah, I'd read enough of those spiritual books where I was thinking that, well, he'll see me and I'll go, oh, at last, you've come. You know, I've been waiting for you. And like, There's a story I found out later, Lumpur Tongrat, when the young Bhikkhu Cha Subhato arrives in Ajahn Tongrat's monastery, he saw him walking through the gate and he said, "Ah, Cha, you've arrived." And that was the first time they'd met. And that was before line and email. So there was no way that Ajahn Tongrat should have known Ajahn Chah's name, but as soon as he walked in the gate, he said, "Ah, Cha, you've arrived." So I thought I was going to get one of those. But I didn't. So when the Ajahn Pabakra, who was the abbot of Wat Nanachat, American bhikkhu, who was a helicopter pilot in the Vietnam War, he introduced me and said, "You know, this young man, he's been living in London, he was in Hampstead, you know, where you visited and stayed last year." And so the Ajahn Chah looked at me and with no smile, Mayim. No smile, he said in Thai, which then Pabakaro translated with great, he had a smile, with great amusement. He said, "Ajahn Chah says, there's a lot of pretty girls in Hampstead." So then, I'm usually not lost for words. I'm a wordy kind of a person. But at that moment, my mind just went, yeah, I didn't know what to think, because he's supposed to be a great spiritual master. How come he's noticing whether women are pretty or not? And why does he say that to me? And is this some kind of secret special message? Or is he putting me down? But oh, well, anyway, I'm beyond all of that kind of thing. I've let go of that kind of worldly sort of interest. You know, that's far, far behind me. But I didn't know what to think. And so I was trying to explain that in my very wobbly, insufficient Thai to Chongsam, but it had a powerful impact, because there was, he was not joking, he was serious. And I, on reflection later on, I felt that was a really helpful teaching, because my thinking was, you know, I'm beyond all of that. But my hormones were busy doing something else. You know, there was still the chelate, the kind of defilement, still the heart was very much affected by sexual desire, and the brain might think I'm beyond that, but the heart, the jitjai itself, it needs some more training. That kind of spiritual perspective, it's not just an idea, it's not just an aspect of our thinking, but it's a whole way of that we relate from the heart. It's to do with an attitude of mind. And so Ajahn Chah made that comment to me, and I think also he would like to test people. He would kind of put something out there and see what you do with it. So maybe he was testing me to see whether I got angry, like, "What do you mean? You know, I'm beyond that," or like, "Yes, it's true, you know, and I'm in love with five of them, But he was sort of just put that to me to see what I would do with it, and then I think he was pleasantly surprised that, you know, 3 or 4 months later, when I asked for the Samanera ordination, they said, "Oh, he's still here." That this one stuck around. And so that was my first dialogue with him. The second one had a very powerful effect also. And so I had become a Pakhao, an eight precept trainee. And Lumpur Cha was over at Wat Pah Nanachat. He would stay for a few days from time to time. And I was the upatak, the attendant for Ajahn Pabakro at that time. So it was my job to get his robes ready and to have his bowl clean and organized to go on the alms round in the morning. So when Lumpur Cha was staying there, then it was my job to prepare Lumpur Cha's robes and his bowl, and Ajahn Pabakro's robes and his bowl. And normally, you know, I was quite good at my duty. On this particular day, when I woke up, I've never been a morning person. I'm more of a night owl, as they say. So I woke up, and I thought, "Oh, I've woken up before my alarm." I thought, "Well, that's good. My alarm clock hasn't gone off." Then, in the old kutis that we had in those days, they were very basic, and there were cracks between the planks of the walls. And then my next thought was, "Oh, the moon is very bright tonight." Then my next thought was, "That's not the moon, that's sunlight." Then my next thought was, eek, I'm late. Then I looked at my clock and it was stopped at something like 20 past one in the morning. So I had no idea what time it was. I didn't have my own watch, just the clock. Didn't know what time it was, so I threw my robes on and rushed through the forest. And then I got to the sala and I saw that the time was 6:25. And they would go on the Bindabat for Bungwai village at 6:30. I thought, oh, okay, 5 minutes, 5 minutes. I'm good, okay, 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 right, it's cool. I can do it. So, again, not being terribly honest with myself, I thought I'd fake it and pretend that I've been around all the time, just maybe you didn't notice me, you know. And so that I kind of get the robes and put them on the arrange them on the Dhamma seat and organize the bowls. And so then I'm just doing up the tags at the bottom of Lumpur Cha's robe, and then he said something in Thai that I didn't understand. And what he said was, non rap roi di, no? Which translates as, sleep is delicious, huh? Sleep is delicious. And he had this big smile. Then he was smiling, like this big yim, like he had this kind of foot-wide grin that he could put on. A really kind of a heartfelt, a really warm, totally warm smile. And again, I didn't quite know what to think, because here's the big authority figure, the Ajahn, the headmaster, the commander-in-chief, you know, and I've done something wrong, I'm the kind of lazy novice, you know, as they have in that old French song, Frère Jacques, you know, the monk that sleeps, who's supposed to be the bell ringer, who's fast asleep and fails to ring the bell. So I was like the Frère Jacques, Brother Jacques, who is still asleep. And yet there was this incredibly warm smile. There's like no punishment, no kind of sense of bad monk, you know. But it's like, yeah, sleep is delicious. He wasn't being cruel. He wasn't being sarcastic. He was just putting straight, yeah, sleep is delicious. It's like, yeah, I've been there. I know. And so that was a moment. I already had a lot of faith in the Buddhadāsa and in the forest monastic life. But at that moment, that was the kind of change of heart where I realized, this is a different kind of institution. This is something I've never met before, where the boss, you know, the headmaster, the commander, the big guy, is, you've done wrong, you've messed up, it's totally public, and is absolutely not a problem. So then I realized, well, this person has complete authority in this community, but he doesn't have to punish the wrongdoers. And instead, what he did was he empathized. To empathize, and then I noticed so many times when people would say, "Oh, Lumpur, I've got a terrible problem. I'm so jealous." Icha mak mak. Then Lumpur would say, "Atamakui mungan, pomgamungan." Yeah, I was that way too. They say, "Oh, I've got so much anger. I blow up all the time." Robert, dalot wela. Oh, chai chai. Pomgamungan. Yeah, I'm that way too. Or me gam mak mak, I'm filled with sexual desire. I can't switch it off. Chai pom ga mungan. So that was almost always his response. And then he would give you a kind of usually a very funny example of him getting lost with getting caught up in anger or doubt or lust or fear. And he had a lot of good stories. And he would say that when people thought, "Well, you're so wise, Lumpur. You're amazingly knowledgeable, and you can help so many people. You must have memorized all the suttas. You must have read the Abhidhamma, and you learn all of the different ways that the mind works." And he says, "No. So if I have any wisdom, it's because I have a lot of kilesa, a lot of defilements. That's why I've developed wisdom, is because of having a heart that has got really confused and angry and heated and lost. And I've learned from the kilate, from the defilements." So another story to tell then was how you could never guess what Ajahn Chah was going to say. So often when people would come to visit, you know, someone would be very polite, very respectful, and they'd ask a really good question. And sometimes you think, oh, that's really interesting. And then sometimes Lung Po would kind of completely ignore them. Like, this, like seeing through somebody. Like, you know, they're so not there that he's not even ignoring them. Kao Jai Mai? Like, that they would be, as if they were completely invisible. And they'd never ask the question. You go, oh, that's really strange. Yeah. Yeah. Lung Po, that person, it seemed like quite a good question, but how come he's ignoring them? And then later on you'd realize, oh, it's because that guy really wanted to be noticed for the one who asks a good question. That it was more about, look at me, you know, how wise and useful, important my questions are. And then somebody else, you'd think, oh, this some kind of local politician, and they look really kind of inflated, and that they're kind of full of themselves, kind of overweight person with wearing expensive jewelry. You think, oh, Lung Po's really going to let this person have it. You know, they're really going to be scolded. Oh, you're so worldly. You're probably take lots of bribes, and you're lost in your kind of greed and wanting to appear sort of special and rich and powerful. And then he would be very kind of kind and humble and friendly. Hey, tamai. But he would read the person rather than the appearance. He would read the situation. And you could never guess how he would react. And sometimes you'd be kind of waiting for him to go one way, then he'd go that way. So it was great fun. Even though you couldn't understand Thai, some other Farang monks or novices would be there who could translate. So that was a really helpful thing, and you could never predict what advice he would give. So the another of the, so maybe to give an example, so at the end of the Pansa, the rains retreat in 1979, I got a telegram from my family in England that my father had a heart attack. And so, could I come? You know, the telegram literally said, Dad very ill, can you come? So I came down from this little branch monastery in Royet, in near Pontong, Selapum Pontong, and came down, and then Ajahn Jagaro, who was the abbot then at Nanachat, took me over to see Lung Po Cha. And again, I couldn't really understand Thai very well. And after Lung Po spoke for about 20 minutes, then Ajahn Jagaro translated for me. He said, well, Lung Po said four things. He said, go to England, take care of your business with your family, pay respects to Ajahn Sumedho, and come straight back. Second thing, go to England, take care of your business with your family, go and pay respects to Ajahn Sumedho, and then stay with him for a year, then after a year, come back here. Okay, number three, go to England, take care of your business with your family, when that's done, pay respects to Ajahn Sumedho, go and stay with him, and do your best to train with Ajahn Sumedho, support him, but if you can't stand it and it's really too much, then you can come back if you really have to. And then number four, you can probably guess, go to England, take care of your business with your family, then go and pay respects to Ajahn Sumedho, live with him and don't come back. And that and all of them were delivered in exactly the same tone. Like, these are your instructions, follow them to the letter. This is exactly what you must do, but four completely different things. So it's like, okay, off you go. So basically the instruction was, you figure it out. So that was an example of how he could be, that you couldn't predict and you couldn't pin him down. So that leads me on to maybe the third way of speaking about who was Ajahn Chah. So one time when I was living at Wat Pah Pong, and I was doing something over in the sala, and Lung Po Cha's kuti was about 100 meters, 150 meters away from the sala. So I was over in the sala, and then a group of visitors arrived. And Ajahn Bunchu, who was the guest monk at that time, he was a very quiet, restrained person, said to me, can you go and tell Lung Po some visitors have arrived and they'd like to see him. So I thought, okay. So I scooted over to Lung Po's kuti, And it was very unusual because he was sitting on this rattan bench, little wicker bench, completely by himself. No one else was around, and he had his eyes closed, he was meditating. So I thought, oh, what should I do? You know, Lumpur's meditating. So I kind of went up to in front of him and thought, well, maybe he'll notice me. No, nothing. No expression, no change. Okay, so I then went away for a... because if I go back to tell Ajahn Chah, he'll just send me back again. So, okay. So I went back and went back to Ajahn Chah's feet and said, Kotot Lumpur. So then he was sitting there and I can't really do his expression, but I'll try. So it was like... Arai. And it's not a very good impersonation, but it was, what happened was that he opened his eyes when I said, excuse me, Lumpur. He opened his eyes and there was absolutely nobody there. Like there was no person there. Like there was, he was looking at me, but there was no personality. There was no, it was hard to describe, but there was nobody there. And then, whoop, this person arrived. Yeah, Ajahn Chah came into being, if you can understand that. So it was like there was this empty space and then whoop, okay, I've got to do the Ajahn Chah thing. So he kind of engaged and said, Arai, what is it? And so I said, oh, Tana Ajahn Bunchu Bokwa Mi Kek Ma Ti Sa La Ka Ka Lumpo. Ma rock cake, dai mai cup. And so then I think he cracked a joke in Isa, Pasa Isa, and I didn't understand. And then he got up and went over. But what was most impactful for me was just seeing a process of a being manifesting. There was no person there, and then whoop, he kind of put on the Ajahn Chah, like putting on the robe, like he put on the person. And it's interesting, the word person in English is very interesting because it comes from the Latin persona, which is a mask. You put on your face, a mask, M-A-S-K. That's what persona means in Latin. That's where the word comes from. So when we say a person, that's our mask. So it was literally showing his mask. So... that quality of Ajahn Chah being a kind of performance, you know, he could do it. He could be the do kind of super strict. He could be very cheerful. He could be incredibly funny. He could be very warm and kind. He could be extremely cold. Tukyang, everything, the whole kind of theater he could do. There was an adaptability in him. So. What this leads me on to is, in a way, the third kind of who was Ajahn Chah. So, there, in a little book called No Ajahn Chah, a little collection of his teachings, it describes, it begins with a pair of conversations. And that says, one day a visitor came to see, to Wat Pah Pong, and they met Ajahn Chah, and they said, who is Ajahn Chah? And he said, this one. This is Ajahn Chah, me. Yeah. Because that was the level of that person's understanding. Another time somebody different came to Wat Pah Pong and came to pay respects to him and said, who is Ajahn Chah? And he said, my me. There is no Ajahn Chah. So there he is sitting, looking at the person saying, there's no Ajahn Chah. So on another occasion, somebody asked him, how old are you? Do you live here year round? And Lumpur's response was, I have no age. I don't live anywhere. So, you know, as a monk, you're not supposed to tell lies. You have to speak the truth. And so, how can you reconcile that? How can you put that together? Okay, he says, I have no age. I don't live anywhere. He said, well, you live at Wat Pah Pong. That's where you live, and you must. You have a birthday. You know, you got a passport with a date in it. That you were born. Here's a body, but he's speaking the truth, and he says, "I have no age," because the Ajahn Chah, I was able to witness in that exchange between him and me under the kuti, was that he recognized that which knows the person is not a person. That which knows this body, this personality, is not a personality. Kachaimai? So that awareness that is the very center of our reality, that quality of knowing, the puru, that awareness knows the person, but it's not a person. It knows birth, but it's not born. It knows death, but it doesn't die. It's akaliko, it's ajati, unborn, amara, deathless. That's my name is deathless, so I have a clue to that, that quality. I live at Amaravati, the deathless realm. So I've got a lot of clues to remind me of that quality. But it's also important to understand that that's not just an attribute of this special being who was born in Bangkok 100 years ago, but this is the very, core of our experience, the very heart of our experience, the huo jai of our experience of moment-to-moment reality is this quality of awareness, the puru. And Lumpur Cha would often say, that's the real refuge. The puru that is your awareness is the refuge that said the Buddha, when we say Buddhang Saranang Gacchami, we're not taking refuge in a statue. We're not taking refuge in the idea of a great being, the masterful and magnificent teacher who lived 2,560 some odd years ago, but rather the puru, Buddha and Pubakban, which is the refuge, is the puru of your own jitta, your own heart, that awareness, because that's a safe place. That is a secure abiding. So when we consider, Ajahn Chah in that way, then it changes the perspective. So when he says, I have no age, I don't live anywhere, that I, if you like, is referring to the Dhamma itself. Like the Dhamma doesn't have an age, right? The Dhamma doesn't live anywhere, it's everywhere and nowhere. Location doesn't apply to the Dhamma. We say, I'm sitting here, we are in BIA, but Dhamma, geography doesn't apply. The Dhamma is timeless, unlocated. It's not bound by time, by place, or by separation, by individuality. So I feel in a way this is one of the most profound but helpful ways of understanding who was Ajahn Chah. Because that if we think Ajahn Chah is the personality that was born in Bangkok 100 years ago, and that's the Ajahn Chah that's important, that without that birth, then you wouldn't have that wisdom that could explain and guide and be a wonderful example for all of us. That wouldn't be there unless that little boy had been born in Bangkok 100 years ago. But this is one of the amazing things, one of the mysterious and beautiful things, and also very much part of Lumpur Cha's teaching, that through that window of the limited and time-bound, that which is bound by birth and death, we are able to awaken to the deathless, the unborn, the undying. That's the amazing thing. The Buddha himself, the Bodhisatta, Siddhartha Gautama, was born in Kapilavastu, a body was born, a life began, but through the window, that viewing point of that life, that mind, the awareness was able to know the timeless, the unborn, the undying, and awaken to that nature, the reality of the Dhamma, the reality of this body, this mind, this world, is the Dhamma itself. So this was also a principle that Lumpur Cha spoke about in terms of monastic training, and he would say, when we are followers of the Buddha, we come to listen to Dhamma, hearing Dhamma, then comprehending the Dhamma, practicing the Dhamma, realizing the Dhamma, So you find that succession, that list, in quite a number of the prasut, of the suttas. But then he added a fifth one, which was being Dhamma. So that it's hearing Dhamma, understanding Dhamma, practicing Dhamma, realizing Dhamma, and then being Dhamma. So if we see it in this way, it's not like you were not the Dhamma and then you became it, but rather it's realizing that, oh, every aspect of this body, this mind, has always been a part of nature. How could it not be? Even, this wooden table, you say, oh, that was a tree. Even this microphone, this metal, came out of the ground. The plastic, this was from oil that was pumped out of the ground and turned into plastic. So every aspect of the material world, every aspect of our mind, our noble thoughts, our metta, karuna, mudita, upekkha, our panya, these are all aspects of Dhamma. But also our anger, our fear, our desire, our worry, these are also aspects of nature. They are part of the kwam tamacha. They're part of the natural order. So that being Dhamma is recognizing, is like changing the view of this life, changing the view of what we are and what everything is, to seeing things in terms of Dhamma. So practicing Dhamma and being Dhamma was one of the most profound and beautiful ways that Lumpo Cha spoke about the practice. Another of the things that was really amazing to me, and maybe it'll be the point I'll finish with, and it was also came up in the interview, was that even though Ajahn Chah was very strict and orthodox as a monk, he followed a very tight schedule. He was very, very strict with the Vinaya discipline. They used to say in Ubon, 3 months in Wat Pah Pong is like 10 years in any other monastery. Lumpo Cha was proud of the fact that the food at Wat Pah Pong was the worst food in the world. Ahan, may aroi ti sut nai lok. And I can, in those days, that was absolutely true. I have personal experience of that. So it was tough living there, and he was very, very disciplined. But yet, when you were with him, you realized, this is the happiest man in the world. This is a man who has no limits. Maimi Kate, there's no boundary. But yet, he's got all these rules, and he has no time to himself. He has people visiting. All day, every day, he's Rup Kek. He would receive guests and visitors and had so many disciples, so many branch monasteries. How is it that this person with so many responsibilities, so many rules, such a tight schedule, tight discipline, how come he is totally free? And that was, you could, just by, say, seeing his body language and hearing his voice, watching his expressions, that you realize that this person has no boundary, no limit. He really is the happiest person in the world. And so, even before I could understand Thai, I could get that feeling. And so, as I was saying to the Chong Sam people, that what arose in my heart when I was a novice was like, whatever I have to do to get to be like that, I'll do it. If it takes 40 years of eating Wat Pah Pong food, fine. I'll do it, no problem. Whatever it takes to be that way, where the freedom of the individual is so clear that, he has a body, he has a personality, he has a lot of responsibilities, but he's totally free. Whatever it takes to be that way, I'll do it. So that the way that he spoke about the training and the way to arrive at that quality of understanding, that total freedom, within the form of the bound and the limited of a body, a personality, the need to eat, the need to breathe, the need to look after your duties. You say you have to respect both the Kong Samut and the Kong Vimut, the conventional truth and the ultimate truth. That if you focus just on the convention, on the Kong Samut, then like you're paying attention just to the rules and the routine and the words of the teaching, then you have no feeling for that which is beyond, that which is unborn, undying, that which is unlimited, that which is free. You can be a very good obedient nun or monk, you can be a very good layperson who does everything properly, but there's no freedom in the heart. It's a, you've learned how to be obedient, to follow, and to obey the rules of the system, but you just learned how to be obedient. Their heart is not free. Similarly, if you just focus on the vimut, on liberation and the transcendent, and you ignore the samut, then you start to, you go without bathing, or you don't look after your clothes, you stop paying attention to the people around you, you become really selfish and insensitive. Basically, you become a real headache to yourself, you become unhealthy, you don't care for the things of the world. You are unconsciously creating a lot of negative karma. And in the West, this is a very popular approach to the teaching. Don't need any rules, just ultimate reality, that's the only thing that matters. Just the Dhamma is the ultimate truth. You are the Dhamma, I am the Dhamma, everything is Dhamma. So you do the dishes. Yeah, you can pay for dinner. Yeah. Everything is Dhamma, you pay. Yeah. Yeah. Everything is Dhamma, I don't need to bathe or wash my clothes. Yeah. Yeah. Everything is Dhamma, I think you're sexually attractive, so I'll just grab hold of you because I want to. I don't care what you feel, I'm just going to grab you. So this happens in spiritual circles in the West, maybe a bit in Thailand, I don't know. But particularly in the 60s and 70s in the West, but still today, many Westerners like this, I'll just take the ultimate and kind of put the conventional reality aside. So this is a way that we create a lot of bad karma, and then that comes back to us, that we receive the toll, the painful results of that. Because even if you want to ignore the conventional truth, then the police will not. Or the person that you're taking advantage of will not ignore it. Or the person who has to pay for your dinner at the restaurant, they will not ignore it. Or the one who has to do all the dishes because you don't want to bother. Kachai mai? You can follow? So, Lumpo Cha said, you have to respect both the samut and the vimut, the conventional and the ultimate. And if we do, then we find that the conventional truth does not limit us, because that is the means whereby we create the most perfect environment in which the ultimate truth can be recognized. So we follow the precepts and we live as a well-integrated human being, a sapurisa, a good person, because that creates the clearest and most harmonious mode of life, mode of living, that helps that ultimate reality of the unborn, the unlimited, the unbound, the undying, the deathless, to be realized. So just recently, for this year, with Lumpo Cha's 100th anniversary, Ajahn Jayasaro just published the biography of Lumpo Cha called Stillness Flowing. And it's a thick book, 800 pages, but it's really good. Obviously, I am biased. I admit, I am biased. But even if I was not a monk in this tradition, I would say it's really well written, and it's a very inspiring and beautiful document. But the title, Stillness Flowing, comes from one of the last kind of teachings that Lumpur gave before he had the stroke and before he stopped being able to speak. And when people came to visit him, he'd say sometimes, have you ever seen flowing water? And they go, yeah, of course. They say, did you ever see still water? And they go, yeah, there's some in your glass. Yeah. So, okay, you've seen still water, you've seen flowing water. Did you ever see still flowing water? They go, is that a Ubon expression? Like, kampiseti Ubon. Still flowing water. Maybe it's the Isan accent, I can't quite get it. Nam Lai Ning, Nam Lai Ning. And then they say, you ever seen that? You know what that is? And he would say, the mind is like still flowing water. It flows. Perceptions and thoughts, they flow. There's the conventional world of seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, thinking. Our moods, they come and go and change. They flow all the time. But then, along with that flow, there is stillness. There is the timeless quality of awareness, that quality of knowing. That which knows the flow is not going anywhere. It is always absolutely here. It's the very center of your world. And it's it's perfectly still. It's not a moving thing that has stopped, but it is that which is, say, free from time and space, that quality of perfect spacious stillness of the heart, that which knows the movement of the mind. So the mind is like still flowing water. There's the stillness and the flowing. The flow doesn't interrupt the stillness doesn't interrupt the flow. They both are there together. We have the conventional and the ultimate, the worldly and the that which is above the world, the Lokiya and the Lokuttara, and they work together. And the Buddha himself, in the word that he used to refer to himself, was Tathagata. And some people say it means one thus gone, completely transcendent, gone beyond. And other people say, no, it means thus come, totally present, absolutely here. And my theory is the Buddha deliberately chose a word with a double meaning. It means both completely here, imminent, present, and attuned to the world, and completely gone, that which is beyond the world, completely transcendent, that they both fit together, they work together. So I offer these thoughts for consideration this evening, and we can have a bit of time for santanatham, for questions and answers. I need to leave at 7:30, that's my limit on the conventional level, because I need to get on a plane back to England tonight. And I'm pretty sure we're packed, but I'm not absolutely sure. My nair. So please, there's some microphones that can be passed around.
If
so
you have questions.
If anyone has any questions, then please don't be shy.
Namaskar, Pajan. I just have some question. Can you share us the story how Long Pu Cha support the Buddhism to go abroad, to go to Western? How did he support the Buddhism to go abroad?
How did Lumpur Cha support Buddhism to go abroad? Well, he accepted Ajahn Sumedho as a disciple. So Ajahn Sumedho, as an American, he had a lot of spiritual interest from early childhood. And after studying Zen Buddhism through books and through some meditation, through a Chinese meditation method, he decided he'd like to take on Buddhist monastic life in Thailand. And even though he'd read Zen, he knew that in Japan, they don't heat the zendos. The meditation halls and they're really cold in the winter. So he said, the reason I didn't go to Japan and become a Zen monk was because I was afraid of the cold. And Thailand is a nice warm country. So the climate in Thailand is what brought Ajahn Sumedho here. So he practiced this Chinese meditation method for a year as a novice in a monastery in Nong Khai. And after a year as a novice, he realized he wanted to live as a monk for a long, long time, for his whole life. But he knew he needed discipline. There was not much Vinaya training in that monastery. And he'd heard of Lumpur Cha from a traveling monk who'd visited Wat Sok Balung in Nong Khai, I think it was called. And and this monk was very impressive in his demeanor, the way he walked, the way he talked, and so on, and the way he kept the rules. So the young novice Sumedho asked his teacher if he could go and train with Ajahn Chah. And then after his ordination as a bhikkhu, he traveled down to Ubon and was introduced by this traveling monk who spoke a bit of English, amazingly, and was introduced to Ajahn Chah. So in those days, it was very much the case that each meditation monastery had a particular method. There's like the Wat Pah Nanachat method, there's the Wat Saket method, the Wat Pleng method. When the young Ajahn Sumedho had been visiting different places, he had assumed that when he was taken to see Ajahn Chah, he'd say, well, you can stay here, but you've got to follow my meditation method, because that's what he'd met at every other place. So one of the reasons there was the kind of chemistry between them was that Ajahn Chah asked him, so what kind of meditation are you doing? And he described this Chinese meditation method, which is taking the question, who am I? Which is very pertinent for this evening. Who am I? And you bring that question into the peaceful mind, and then watch the feelings of I and me and mine arising, and then to let go of them. That's a brief description of the method. And so then Ajahn Chah asked him, so what are the results? Is that something worth doing? He said, yeah, I did it for a couple of years as a layman. I've been doing it intensively for the last year in Nongkai, and I find very, very good results. And to his amazement, Ajahn Chah didn't say, well, you better stop doing that, that's all wrong, you do my method instead. Then Ajahn Chah said, well, fine, just carry on doing that. Oh, really? And then later on he asked Ajahn Chah, had you ever heard of that method before? And Lumpur said, no. But he was ready to trust, well, this American has been doing this for 3 years, and he's obviously very committed. He's a bhikkhu, he wants to train. He says it's working for him, okay, I'll go with that. Because he also knew that it's not just the technique that you use, it's not just obeying the technique, but what do you do with hunger? What do you do with being praised? What do you do with being criticized? What do you do with discomfort, being eaten by mosquitoes? He knew that most Dhamma training is situational. It's from the situation of living. So that formed the link with the Western Sangha. Then, later on, Ajahn Chah asked Ajahn Sumedho, so Sumedho, do you think you'll ever go back and live as a monk in the West? And then the response that the young Bhikkhu Sumedho said was like, well, no. I mean, how could you live as a monk in the West? You know, you couldn't go on Bindabad. You know, no, and it's, you know, how could you live as a bhikkhu in a non-Buddhist countries? And then Ajahn Chah just said, do you mean to say there are no kind people in America? And at that moment, that was when Ajahn Sumedho realized, oh, I guess I'm going back. Because he'd had a very narrow view that you have to be able to walk through the village and have everybody out on their knees at, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning. That's not going to happen in Seattle, you know, where he was from. But Ajahn Chah had a bigger view, and he realized it's not just the conventions of this country, but rather, you know, human kindness and human suffering is the same everywhere. And so that if you live in a good way, then the kind people will recognize your goodness and they'll rise up. And that's exactly true. Like, we go Tudong in the West. One of the monks at Amaravati just been 6 weeks or 2 months on Tudong through England and Wales. So being fed by complete random strangers. No upatak, no layperson following around with a car and a pizza, you know. Just walking into a village with an empty bowl. No money, no plan, no looksit. Just an empty bowl and sadhar. And he's lived for the last couple of months just that way. And many of us have done that for many times. So that openness to different ways of thinking, different ways of acting, was very attractive. And so many Westerners then came, and they, even though Ajahn Chah could never speak any English, just a few words, like, where is the toilet? That was the first sentence he wanted to learn in English. It's very practical. Yeah. He mostly used the situational teaching. So people would often ask, how do you train these Westerners? You don't speak English. He said, well, how do you train your water buffalo? You want it to go left, you hit it on the right. You want it to go right, you hit it on the left. It's like, it's not much different. So that it wasn't a language issue, but he was able to read people, read personalities, and then help you to teach yourself. And then when he was invited to go to the West, then he just said, yeah, sure, I'll go visit. And then what he saw in the West, that he felt, yeah, these people are, they have faith, they have interest, they have commitment. And also he was impressed by Westerners sitting in a meditation retreat, you know, bit wacha for 10 days. He said, oh, I could never get the monks of Wapapong to sit this still. So he was impressed by the rabiyap, the kind of discipline that they could have on a retreat. But also he saw that people didn't like sila, a chop. Panya and samadhi, chop. Sila, So he mostly spoke about pavana, meditation, and panya, and then he said they'll find out about sila for themselves later on. So any other questions? Maybe you, there must be a doubt in the room somewhere.
We still have.
Namaskar, Ajahn Chah. To be trained directly under Ajahn Chah and to be trained directly under Ajahn Sumedho, what's the difference? And these days there are many, many monasteries in the West. How did it work to be trained like indirectly from Rupa Sumedho instead of Ajahn Chah?
Well, having everything in English was made things very different. So that, because in a way, Lumpo Cha, he set, I didn't spend that much time with him. I was only about 3 weeks altogether with him. Mostly I was away in Wat Nanachat, and when I lived at Wat Bapong, Lumpo Cha was away in the West. So I was only actually side by side with Lumpo Cha about 3 weeks. Less than 1 month, definitely. So mostly what Lumpo Cha did was that he created an atmosphere wherein you could teach yourself. That was kind of his witty, his method. Was that, and he would keep saying like, I'm not the teacher, you're the teacher. I can help you to teach yourself, but you can sit right up close to me, you know, within, you know, 2 meters and listen to me all day. But if you don't do what I say, if you don't teach yourself, then it's as if you're 100 miles away. So, in my efforts to teach use the environment of the monastery to teach myself, I was missing a lot. And so then going to be with Ajahn Sumedho, and when I first joined him, he was giving a couple of Dhamma talks every day. So, you know, and it was an amazing time because it was like so much of what was sort of in the air at Wat Bapong, Wat Nanachat, or that was, the teachings were around and you were sort of trying to make sense of and trying to explain to yourself or work out for yourself. Ajahn Sumedho was able to kind of fill it all out in glorious three-dimensional technicolor detail. So it was like having sort of been making it, you know, walking through the sort of rough and rocky mountains and sort of struggling over difficult paths and then coming down into a kind of a beautiful lush valley and go, oh, this is great. You know, it's cooler and there's things to eat, there's places to rest, there's good company. So it was made a huge difference to me. Idealistically speaking, I should be able to say it didn't make any difference. But being true to how it was like, oh, this is great. Because I wasn't able to figure it all out on my own. I wasn't able to teach myself very effectively. And having Ajahn Sumedho, from his experience, able to spell it out, and his, you know, he'd been a bhikkhu for about 12 years by that time, when I showed up in England. That made a huge amount of difference. So Lumpo Sumedho was ordained in 67, and I joined him in 79. So he was been a bhikkhu for 12 years. So that was, it was kind of wonderful to sort of be nourished by his experience and to have everything spelled out. So I had great respect and love for Lumpo Cha, but I spent 13 years with Lumpo Sumedho, kind of at his. So the difference between 3 weeks with Lumpo Cha and 13 years with Lumpo Sumedho, not only was it in English, but there was a lot more of it. Okay, one more, and then we should wrap up, because there's always photographs and goodbyes. So. In my experience,
maybe
speaking of experience.
Question?
Any?
Oh, maybe not.
Okay,
maybe.
Pull out.
Oh, at the back.
There's one at the back there. Can you wait for a microphone, please?
I'm not sure if I can.
Can you wait for a microphone? Thank you.
So what is the way you can describe Lumpo Chai's method of meditation? You've discussed the other forms that you've encountered, like the Chinese methods, but what was a method that Lumpo Chai used himself?
Well, he was like a kind of magician. He would keep pulling rabbits out of his hat. Yeah, he would come up with meditation methods so that he most often taught mindfulness of breathing, often using the mantra Buddho, like Bud on the in-breath, Do on the out-breath, walking meditation, walking at an ordinary natural pace on a path about 20, 25 meters long. He would teach a lot of contemplation, like using reflections on uncertainty. So one very simple method is every time your mind forms a judgment of liking or disliking, approving or disapproving, just to ask yourself, is that so? Is that a sure thing? Or that, like coming here this evening, I was supposed to get here at 5 o'clock for the interview with the Chong Sam. The Bangkok roads dictated differently. So we didn't get here until about 5:40. So are we going to get there in time? Will I get there by 6 o'clock for the Dhamma talk? My nair. Is that a sure thing? So a lot of active contemplation, or an even more simple reflection, just to say, so? I'm really happy about this. So? This is a disaster. So? This is exactly what I wanted. So? Like, do you really? I can't really believe that she thinks like that. So? And it's extremely simple, but if you apply it, it has a whole life-changing. He would do things like a kind of indoor version or a pocket version of walking meditation. He'd say, take something like a glass, put it down, time it for a minute, and then move it over here. Leave it there for a minute, then move it back. Leave it there for a minute, then move it back. Do that for an hour. And see what your mind does with that. Like, oh, this is stupid, why am I doing this? This is crazy, Lumpu Cha must be a nutcase. It's just picking up, putting down. What's the problem? Why does my mind make a difficulty out of this? So watching what your mind does with doubt. A monk who had a lot of anger habits, he gave him a bowl of water. So take a kannam, a dish of cold water, put that in the corner of your kuti and just look at the bowl of cold water as a way of cooling your mind down. Sometimes he would describe some kind of meditation method and they say, oh, Lumpur, how does that work? And he said, I don't know, I just made it up. But you know, give it a try and see what happens. So it really was like a magician. You know, there was just no end of the kind of practices that he could come up with. One really interesting one is like, say if you have a lot of anger, and he say, okay, now make anger your meditation object. Think of something that makes you angry, and then keep your attention on the anger. And when the anger slips away, bring it back. Just like if you're doing mindfulness of breathing, as soon as your attention wanders from the breath, bring it back. So you say, stay angry for an hour. And it's really hard to do. It's because anger only works in kind of short flashes. And he said, by the time you get to the end of the hour, the anger will disappear, at least for a day. So these kind of things, he was amazingly creative. And if you asked a whole list of different people who trained with him, different practices, you'd probably come up with 100 or a couple of hundred that he suggested from one time or another. So there was no Ajahn Chah method. A continuity of mindfulness, you know, paying attention to the flow of your moods and thoughts, was also what he often stressed as he said, if your peace resides in the meditation hall, then you're not going to have much peace, because most of life is not in the meditation hall. So a continuity of mindfulness to watch your moods through the day is the most important thing. And then, you know, if you're confused, make confusion your object. Yeah, if you're angry, make anger your object. Yeah, if you're doubting, make doubt your object. Don't think, oh, I can't meditate because I'm confused. So it's like the ancient method of building, when you try to repair an old house and there's some kind of beam that sticks halfway across the living room. So if you can't hide it, make a feature of it. There's a big rock in the garden, okay, just plant some flowers around it, you know. Can't get rid of it, okay, make a feature of it. If what's happening is confusion, okay, let's look at confusion. Let that be what you learn from. So I think that's enough for this evening. And whatever is useful, please take it with you. Whatever is not, leave it behind.